When I was little, I thought being in a movie or on television was as simple as knowing when and where the story was taking place and walking into it. If I could find the Temple of Doom, I could wake Harrison Ford from the black sleep of Kali Ma. Short Round found it. Tell me when and where he's touching gloves, and I'm Rocky's cut man. I could kick it in the Cosby kitchen. If only I had their address. I thought it was all just a matter of being at the right place at the right time. I didn't realize it, but at 7, I'd kind of figured out the entertainment business. The movies and just about anything I saw on television mesmerized me. They took me on amazing journeys, taught me about the world, they made me laugh, and they made me cry. And I carried these movies inside me long after they ended, and I desperately wanted to be a part of them. One morning, when I was 7, living in Salem, Arkansas, I was watching my favorite show and I realized something. It had given me a piece of the puzzle. It told me exactly where it was taking place, the very street, but I didn't know how to get there. The show's theme song taunted me with this burning question. I had 20 minutes before the action ended. I needed a quick route. My 7-year-old mind came up with the best possible solution. I'll jump through the television screen. A swirling rainbow vortex will open up and transport me safely to Sesame Street. Perhaps this was the movie, perhaps this was the magic of television everyone talked about. I was sold on the idea. My only concern was getting back. What if my mom came in the room, flipped over to Donahue or something, and closed the wormhole back to the den? I didn't want to stay on Sesame Street forever, and I didn't want to alarm my mom should she not be able to find me. So I wrote her a note. Mom, I'm on Sesame Street. Don't change the channel. If I can't get back, will you come get me? Love, Warren. I placed the note on top of the TV and clinked my knuckles on the glass picture tube. It was quite solid. This gave me pause, but I couldn't hesitate long. The show ended shortly. I stood back several paces and prepared to dive head first through the television. 3, 2, a commercial. Perhaps it was divine intervention. This break gave me time to question the validity of my vortex theory and dwell on that hard, hard glass. I tore up the note and thought I should seek advice before risking bodily harm to do math with a vampire. I think it was palm olive that saved my life. That evening, I was lying on the floor in the living room watching a movie, my parents sitting in their recliners behind me. I turned to them, pointed to the television, and said, "How do I get there?" My mom looked up from her magazine and said, "Get where?" "On TV," I said, "I want to be in the movies." With a smile on her face, she replied, "You become an actor. Then you go to Los Angeles or New York, because that's where they make movies." My 7-year-old perception of New York was that it was cold, there were rats, and somewhere in the city was a big apple. Los Angeles was warm. It had palm trees, and a magician that played basketball lived there. Los Angeles it was. From that moment on, I knew what I was going to do with my life. I held on to that dream every second of every day, and my greatest supporter and biggest fan was my mom. She was born Joe Carroll Sullivan in Jonesboro, Arkansas in 1949, named after Joe Carroll Dennison, Miss America, 1942. My grandmother saw Miss Dennison's name on a billboard. and apparently she liked it. My mom's persona was billboard worthy, and to those that knew her, her name deserved the lights. She had southern charm and city wit. She was creative and elegant, humble and wise. She was funny and fearless, and she had a flair for the dramatic. She had been an actor. Named the best actress in the state of Missouri in 1967. Not only did she encourage me, she directed me. She was my high school speech and drama teacher. I took all her classes and performed in all her plays. When I left for Los Angeles, she cheered the loudest and cried the hardest. My first day in LA, I saw Tom Hanks and Steven Spielberg. My second day, I got a handshake from Nicolas Cage. I had arrived. It was an actor's paradise. Over the next several years, I had some amazing experiences. When things got tough, a phone call to Mom would take me from the pit of despair to the top of the mountain. Her belief in me and a producer's casting tidbit changed the course of my career and my life. I was auditioning for a film that takes place during World War II. The moment my audition ended, the producer began whispering to the director. The self-conscious actor in me began to think, "I didn't like it." Then the director spoke, "You got the part." I was thrilled. I was going to be Private First Class Ash. A few moments later, the producer, expressing his joy in finally casting the role, said 5,000 actors submitted for the part that I just got. I had a 5,000-to-1 shot. I thought, those odds are not good. This was a short and low-budget film. What were the odds like for bigger projects? I thought, I don't want to keep betting on someone else to put me in their movie. I'll make my own. So I began writing a screenplay. It was a thriller to be set in the South. It centered around a man who lives with and takes care of his aging and agoraphobic mother. Her condition has become severe. She says very little and often sits catatonic, staring off into the distance. Her son struggles to understand her illness and its mysterious cause, but always hoping she'll return from the distant place in which she disappears. I was going to play the lead role, and I thought, who better to play my mom than my mom? She was on board. We were going to share the screen. It would be magical. I sold my place, Craigslisted my furniture, and moved in with my parents, now living in Thayer, Missouri. I began building sets, securing locations, gathering props, and filling out all the necessary paperwork. Things with the movie were progressing, but so was something else. My mom's demeanor began to change. She was becoming withdrawn and apathetic. Her bright, talkative spirit was now just a quiet, dim light. And for someone always on the go, she didn't want to leave the house anymore. She was diagnosed with a rare neurological disorder called progressive supranuclear palsy. A part of her brain was dying, and she was too. Her disease progressed rapidly. She became confined to her home, needing assistance to walk, bathe, and even eat. Her sparkling, colorful eyes, now foggy and dull, and fixed in a distant stare. She spoke very little as her mind and body faded away. She resembled the character I had written for her with eerie similarity. And like my character, I yearned for my mom's return and one more glimpse of the woman that I once knew. She needed me more than I needed to make a movie. So I became a caretaker instead of a filmmaker. In the movie, the woman dies in her home, in her kitchen, as her son holds her in her arms. My parents' kitchen was going to be used to film that scene. My mom died just a few feet from the place I'd written her death scene to be filmed. When she passed, I was by her side, holding her hand in mine. If life is a stage, then her performance was beautiful. She said many times, "The show must go on." And though I will have to cast another in the part, my mom's role can never be replaced. Her story ended, but like those movies that stayed with me long after they were over, she too will forever be a part of me, teaching me, inspiring me, making me laugh, and always reminding me to never let go of that little boy standing in front of the TV, determined to leap toward his dreams.